Hello. Today we will start a new topic. As you see, advanced counting techniques. And the first subtopic of this advanced counting techniques will be the study of generating functions. Okay, before defining what generating functions are, let me motivate you by using a couple of examples. First, let us look at this example. This is a counting problem. Suppose that you appear in four tests. The first one is on algorithms, second one is on bioinformatics, third one is on compilers, and the fourth one is on discrete mathematics, discrete structures. Now, suppose that these are all short tests. And in each of these tests, you can bag a mark in the range 0 to 10, and let's say these are all integers, no half, something like that, 0, 1, 2, up to 10, any of this. So the counting question is, in how many ways can you get a total of 25 marks? Okay, this is a valid counting problem, not very difficult, but makes sense in this current context. So here are some examples. Maybe in algorithms 5, bioinformatics 5, compilers 10, discrete structure 5, algorithms 10, bioinformatics 5, compilers 5, discrete structures 5, all these two possibilities. So there are many other possibilities. Also note that this is ordered. 5 plus 5 plus 10 plus 5 is not same as 10 plus 5 plus 5 plus 5. Okay. Anyway, whatever it is. So the question is, I want to count in how many ways you can get a total of 25 marks. Okay. So, let us frame this problem algebraically in order to arrive at a good solution procedure. You have four tests, so algorithms, you consider this polynomial, 1 plus a plus a square plus a cube and so on. So 1 stands for you have got 0, a power 0. A stands for you have got 1. A power 6 means you have got 6 in algorithms, 9 in algorithms and so on. Okay. Likewise, we may have a similar thing for bioinformatics. 1 plus b plus b square up to b power 10. Compilers, 1 plus c square up to c power 10. And finally, discrete mathematics, 1 plus d square up to d power 10. So, these polynomials you have just constructed. Okay. Now, you multiply these four polynomials. So, you consider the product a, b, c, d. And then, you look at all terms in the product of the form a power I, b power j, c power k, d power l, such that I plus j plus k plus l is 25. And the number of terms of this form with this condition will essentially give you the number of ways you can get 25 in the four courses. Okay. Unfortunately, so far we have made very little progress. The original counting problem essentially remains. So, but still this is no real progress actually. Still, this is an interesting first step toward solving this problem. So, let us use this insight. Okay. So, you are considering all terms of the form a power I, b power j, c power k, d power l, I plus j plus k plus l equal to 25. So, as such, whether this is a or b or c or d, it does not really matter because you are interested only in the sum. So, what we do, we do not make different things for a, b, c, d. Instead, we call them, all of them, x. So, we take a equal to x, b equal to x, c equal to x and d equal to x. then this product ABCD simplifies to this. 1 plus x square plus x cube up to x power 10 whole power 4. Now all of ABCD have become x. And then I can do some kind of algebraic manipulation on this expression in this form. So this quantity is nothing but 1 minus x power 11 over 1 minus x. So this raised to the power 4. 1 minus x power 11 by 1 minus x whole raised to the power 4. And then I can expand this 1 minus x power 11 whole power 4, and I can also use the generalized binomial theorem for expanding 1 over 1 minus x power 4. So this result comes to be like this. Okay, no, this is better. Okay, so this comes like this. This one is simple binomial theorem. 1 minus 4 choose 1 x power 11 plus 4 choose 2 x power 22 and so on. And this is the application of generalized binomial theorem. I plus 3 choose I x power I greater than or equal to 0. Okay. Now, I need to collect the coefficient of x power 25 in this expansion. So, for example, I will take the 25th x power 25 for multiplying with this, does not contribute any power of x. This contributes a power of 11. So 25 minus 11, 14, x power 14 coefficient I will have to consider. 22, so I have to consider x cube coefficient. And this 33 and 44 are too big to matter in the coefficient of x power 25. So eventually I get this answer. Put I equal to 25. 25 plus 3 choose 25 minus 4 choose 1 14. 14 plus 3 choose 14 plus 4 choose 2 and 3. 3 plus 3 choose 3, which simplifies to something like 676. At last we have got an algebraic procedure to handle the original counting problem. Okay. So now I leave it to you as an not so difficult exercise that the same expression like this or this can be obtained using the principle of inclusion and exclusion. So you figure out how. Okay. But here of course we have followed an algebraic procedure, but this also has a combinatorial interpretation which you can derive using the principle of inclusion and exclusion. Okay. So, in order to motivate further, let us look at a second example, which we have already seen earlier, combination with repetitions. Okay. So, once again, consider the same setting. Suppose you want to choose R objects with repetition from a set of n distinct objects. Okay. And you know the answer is n plus r minus 1, choose r or choose n minus 1. Okay. So I will algebraically derive this. Okay. So, each object can be chosen a maximum of r times. So, I can consider this. 1 plus x square plus up to x power r, and there are n objects, raise this to the power n, and then look at the coefficient of x power r in this expansion. Okay. So this is fine. The point is that we may even allow each object to appear r plus 1 times, r plus 2 times, r plus 3 times, any number of times. But if you choose some object r plus 1 times, they cannot contribute anything to a sum of r, right? But their presence does not matter. Okay. Indeed, their presence actually simplifies the process. Okay. So, instead of considering this polynomial, what I will do, I will consider this power series. Okay. I will not stop this polynomial at this point, but will keep on adding terms until infinity. Okay. So, we look at this. 1 plus ax plus x square. Now, it is not ending at x power r. It is proceeding to infinity. Whole power n. The reason is that now I have a very simple formula. 1 over 1 minus x whole power n. Okay. And this is same as 1 over 1 minus x whole power n. And therefore, by the generalized binomial theorem, this can be written as the infinite sum n plus I minus 1 choose I times x power I. This sum extends for all I greater than or equal to 0 integers. Okay. And then if I want to pick the coefficient of r from this infinite expansion, power series expansion, it will be n plus r minus 1 choose r. So that is the final answer. And we already know this answer. We have derived this using combinatorial arguments. Okay, earlier in the very first chapter itself. Okay, so now these two examples motivate us to define what is called a generating function of a sequence. Okay, so what is this? Suppose that a0, a1, a2, a3, the nth term is an, is an infinite sequence of real numbers. Okay. We usually concentrate on real numbers, but they may be complex numbers without any harm. Okay. But for most of this, I would say, for most of our purpose, they need not be complex numbers. Okay. In the current context, they may be restricted to real numbers only. Anyway, I highlight this nth term as an. So, this is an infinite sequence. So, I am starting from 0. So, this is basically at position n plus 1. Okay. Anyway, that doesn't really matter. So, I will always highlight these nth terms, which appear in the n plus 1th position. Okay. Now, the generating function of this sequence is defined as the infinite sum a0 plus a1x plus a2x square and so on. The nth term is anx power n, and this is an infinite series. Okay. This is just a definition. We will see how we can use this to solve many practical counting problems. Okay. So, this is the definition. Fairly straightforward. Now, such a power series is usually treated in the formal sense. Okay. So, this power series is called formal in the sense that we usually never want to put a value of x. So, x is just a placeholder in this context. We do not want to put x equal to 1, x equal to half, x equal to minus 5, something like that. Okay. So, we usually do not put any value for x, it's just a placeholder. That is why such power series are called formal. Okay. And since x is just a placeholder, we are not putting any value of x, the convergence issues of this sequence a0, a1, a2, an, or the series a0 plus a1x plus a2x square, this is usually not of any concern in this concept, in this context. Okay. The convergence of the series or even the sequence is usually not an issue. However, in rare situations, we may want to put some value for x. In fact, we will see an example where we actually put a value of x. And if that is the case, then the series must converge. Otherwise, we cannot talk about what is the value of a of x at a particular point x. Okay. So, if you want to put a value, then you must consider the convergence issues. Okay. Anyway. So, this definition is, I believe, fairly straightforward. Let us now look at some examples and applications. Okay, so examples first. One by one, let us see. So let us use a positive integer n. Then by the binomial expansion, 1 plus x whole power n is the generating function of n choose 0, n choose 1, n choose 2, up to n choose n. And this is followed by an infinite number of zeros, because this is a terminating expansion when n is a positive integer. Then you can also think about this geometric thing. 1 minus x power n over 1 minus x is nothing but 1 plus x square plus x power n minus 1. Therefore, this is the generating function of 1, 1, 1 up to n times. Then this is followed by, there are no other terms, so this is followed by an infinite number of zeros. Okay. So, that's the second example. So, these are essentially all finite sequences, but by padding an infinite number of zeros, I am making these sequences infinite. But you also often deal with truly infinite sequences like this example. Next example illustrates. So 1 minus 1 over 1 minus x is 1 plus x square and so on. Therefore, this is the generating function of 1, 1, 1, okay, and so on. We also know, for example, this expansion, 1 over 1 minus x square is nothing but 1 plus 2x plus 3x square plus 4x cube and so on. So this is the generating function of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, okay, n plus 1 appearing in the nth position, not nth position, n plus first position as a coefficient of x power n, okay. Now, if I want to generate 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and so on, instead of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all I need to do is just a multiply this by x, okay. So this will now be 0 plus x plus 2x square plus 3x cube plus 4x power 4 and so on. So this is now the generating function of 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on. Okay. Now I do a standard trick. If I differentiate this with respect to x, then 1 will come here, this 2 is multiplied by another 2, this 3 will be multiplied by another 3, this 4 will be multiplied by another 4, n will be multiplied by this n. And then what is that thing? Derivative of this quantity is nothing but, you can work out that this derivative is 1 plus x over 1 minus x whole cube. This is 1 square plus 2 square x plus 3 square x square and so on, 4 square x cube. So in general, I can say that this function is the generating function. This expression is the generating function of the squares, 1 square, 2 square, 3 square, 4 square, 5 square and so on. And if I want to start from 0 square, then once again I multiply by another x. So x times this quantity is the generating function of 0 square, 1 square, 2 square, 3 square, 4 square, 5 square and so on. And then if I want to find the generating function of 1 cube, 2 cube, 3 cube, 4 cube, 5 cube, what do I have to do? I have to once again differentiate this with respect to x. Okay, so this, you can keep on doing this. And whatever you get, multiply by x, you will generate 0 cube, 1 cube, 3 cube and so on. Okay. So, these are some examples. Fine. Some more examples, I think, we have in our set. Okay, so this is yet another very important expression. So, instead of 1 over 1 minus x, if I do something like 1 over 1 minus alpha x, where alpha is a real number, or maybe a complex number. Sometimes we will have alpha equal to complex numbers. Anyway, it's a real or complex number, maybe an integer also. So this can be now expanded as 1 plus alpha x plus alpha square x square plus alpha cube x cube and so on. So this is the generating function of the geometric series 1, alpha, alpha square, alpha cube and so on. Okay. Fine. So this expression we will use pretty often. Okay. Now some general small theorems, I would say. These are so obvious, we can also call them examples. Suppose that A is the generating function of the sequence A0, A1, A2, and B is the generating function of B0, B1, B2. Then if I add these two, AX plus BX, this will be the generating function of A0 plus B0, A1 plus B1, A2 plus B2, and so on. For example, suppose we have seen the generating function for n square. We have also seen the generating function of n. So if I want to obtain the generating function of n square plus n, let us go to the. So this is the generating function of n, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is the generating function of 1 square, 2 square, 3 square, plus 3 square, 4 square, and so on, squares. So if I want to obtain the generating function of n square plus n, I just have to add this and this. It's as simple as this. Okay. So, this is one issue. Now, likewise, if I just subtract bx from ax, this will generate a0 minus b0, a1 minus b1, a2 minus b2, and so on. Okay. But this is a very trivial case, so I didn't write it. But what happens if I multiply ax with bx? So what thing does it generate? Okay, let us look at this. Now the product is the generating function of what is called the convolution. First term is a0 b0, a0 b1 plus a1 b0. Third term is a0 b2, a1 b1 plus a2 b0. In general, the nth term is a0 bn plus a1 bn minus 1 plus a2 bn minus 2 and so on. Okay. So this formula is called convolution. At the end, we will make a good use of this convolution formula. At the end of this section, when we derive the generating function of Catalan numbers, anyway, that will come at the end. This is fine. In particular, if I take bx equal to 1 over x, then all of this b0, b1, b2, all these things will be 1. So if I take bx equal to 1, 1 over 1 minus x, then this formula says that ax over 1 minus x is a generating function of the prefix sums a0, a0 plus a1, a0 plus a1 plus a2, a0 plus a1 plus an in general. Okay. Okay, so these are simple formulas which can be derived fairly straightforwardly, in a fairly straightforward manner. So I am not deducing these formulas. You can see this evidently. Now let us look at some applications. Although I continue to call them examples, let us look at some non-trivial applications in counting problems. Okay. The first application goes like this. Suppose that I want to count in how many ways we can place 20 marbles in 3 boxes such that the following 2 conditions are satisfied. 1. Each box must contain at least 2 marbles, and 2. The third box is not allowed to contain more than 10 marbles. Okay. This is fine. So the third box will contain 2 to 10 marbles, no more than that. Every other box may contain 2 to up to whatever is allowed. Okay. So, this is again a generic counting problem. And then, let us look at this. So, of course, we have to look at the coefficient of x power 20, but where? The first two box will contain 2 or 3 or 4 or any number of marbles. Of course, in this case, the maximum number of marbles possible is 20. But again, in order to simplify our expressions, we will assume that there are infinitely many marbles available. So, x squared plus x cubed plus x squared. Now, this is for box 1 and box 2. And box 3, this is a finite thing. It cannot go beyond x power 10. So, x squared plus x cubed up to x power 10. Because of this condition 2. Now, let us do some kind of simplifications on this. First, take x square out of everything. So, that will be x power 6. Now, this is a familiar sum. And this is also familiar, but it's just terminating. So, 1 plus x up to x power 8. So, I can replace each of this 1 plus x plus x square plus this sum by 1 over 1 minus x. It appears twice. Here I have 1 minus x power 9 over 1 minus x, this quantity. So, this simplifies to x power 6, 1 minus x power 9, 1 minus x whole cube. Now I expand this 1 over 1 minus x whole cube by the generalized binomial theorem. And this gives me this expression. X power 6 minus x power 15, summation, I plus 3 minus 1 choose I, 3, this is 3 here, so I plus 2 choose I, x power I. This is also same as I plus 2 choose 2, x power I, okay. So, I need to collect the coefficient of x power 20 from this. So, if I look at this x power 6, then I have to consider 14 here, right? 6 plus 14. And another term will come 5. 15 plus 5. So 14 plus 2 choose 14 for this. 5 plus 2 choose 5 for this. So this simplifies to 16 choose 2 minus 7 choose 2. And this evaluates to something like 99. Okay. So, by using this algebraic techniques, I can easily solve counting problems with enough restrictions like this. At least 2 marbles, at most 10 marbles. Okay. Now, let us look at a slightly more complicated application of generating functions. Okay. Suppose now I want to count how many 5 element subsets of 1 through 20 are there such that they do not contain consecutive integers. Okay. So if you choose 1, you cannot choose 2. If you choose 2, you cannot choose 3 or 1, and so on. Okay. So, how many 5 element subsets of 1, 2, 3, 4 up to 20 do not contain consecutive integers? Okay. So, I reframe this counting problem as follows. Suppose that a1, a2, a3, a4, a5, 5 elements, so this is, let this be such a subset as that A1 and A2, and suppose that they are organized in ascending order. So, A1 less than A2, A2 less than A3, A3 less than A4, A4 less than A5. Moreover, A1 and A2 are not consecutive. A2 and A3 are not consecutive. A3 and A4 are not consecutive. A4 and A5 are not consecutive. Also, I use the relation that A5 is less than or equal to 20. And A1 is greater than or equal to 1. Okay. So, I call this 1 A0, 20 A6. Okay. So I have, therefore, a0 is 1. This is less than equal to the first one. This is less than a2. Not only less than, a1 is actually less than a2 minus 1. Anyway, for the moment, I am not considering this. In the next step, I will do it. a2 less than a3, a3 less than a4, a4 less than a5. This is less than equal to 20, which I call a6. Okay. So now the trick is, I consider these differences, a1 minus a0, a2 minus a1, a3 minus a2, up to a6 minus a5. So I introduce these differences, di equal to ai plus 1 minus ai. Okay. Then, what do I have? D0, which is nothing but A1 minus A0. This is less than equal to sine. So we have D0 and D5. This is less than equal to, this is less than equal to. Okay. So we have D0, D5 greater than equal to 0. But if I look at this intermediate things, they, D1, they are not only greater than 0, since a1 and a2 are not consecutive, we have d1, d2, d3, d4 must be greater than or equal to 2. Finally, if I add this d0, d1, d2, d3, d4, d5, so this sums telescope, what remains is only a6 minus a0. Which is 20 minus 1, 19. Okay. So the sum of these differences must be 20 minus 1 equal to 19. So now we have reduced the problem to a more conventional form. Sum is 19. This one is greater than this one, and this one are greater than or equal to 0, whereas this one, this one, this one, and this one are greater than or equal to 2. Therefore, I consider this power series. In fact, I will consider the coefficient of exponent 19 in the power series. For d0 and d5, I start from 1. Because they are greater than or equal to 0, so 1 plus x plus x square plus blah 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 whole square, there are 2 of them, d0 and d5, whereas for d1, d2, d3 and d4, I start from 2, x square plus x cube plus x power 4 and so on, there are 4 of them, so this to the power 4. Now if I simplify this, I can take out x square from each of these, okay. Then I have x power 8 times this quantity 6 times, and that is simplified as 1 minus x whole power 6, 1 over that quantity. Okay. Then I use again the generalized binomial theorem. This is nothing but I plus 6 minus 1 choose I, that is I plus 5 choose I, x power I. And I want the coefficient of x power 19. So I will put 19 here. 19 plus 5 choose 19. Okay. I think I made a mistake. X power 19. Okay. 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 Sorry. Anyway, Where am I? Okay, here. I should choose, no, this is fine. Sorry. X power 8 is coming from here. So if I take, okay, I see. Still there is a mistake. X power 8 is coming here and I am interested in X power 19. So I take I equal to 11. Okay. So this is a problem. So instead of 12, I should take 11. Here also I should take 11. And this should be 16. And this is not the correct thing. Whatever it is correct, I can work out. What is this? 16 choose 5. Four, three, six, eight. Okay. This will be 4, 3, 6, 8. Okay. So 8 plus 11, 19. Okay. So 11 plus 5 choose 11. That is 16 choose 5. Okay. 4, 3, 6, 8. Okay. Okay. Anyway. Sorry for the mistake. Okay. So this is yet another interesting example. Now let us look at our last example in this lecture. So we talk about a particular type of distribution, probability distribution, called geometric distribution. Okay, this works as follows. Suppose that you keep on tossing a coin until you get the first head. Okay, we toss a coin repeatedly until a head appears. Okay, and let us suppose that the coin is biased. Okay, that means it's not necessarily that the head comes with probability half and the tail comes with probability half. So let us generalize this situation. Suppose that P is the probability of head in each toss. So this does not change. This remains constant in each toss. Then the probability of tail is nothing but 1 minus P, which I may call Q. That also remains constant in all tosses. Okay. Now, I can make this simplifying assumption that P strictly lies between 0 and 1, and therefore Q strictly lies between 0 and 1, because if P is 0, then head will never appear. Okay. And if P is 1, in the very first toss itself, head will appear. So these two cases are not really interesting. Okay. But actually I will use this 0 less than Q less than 1. Okay, so anyway, so now let us consider a random variable g, which stands for the number of times you need to toss in order to get the first head. So what values does g take? You have to make at least one toss to get a head. So it may be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So all positive integers. So g assumes only positive integer values. And what is the probability that g assumes the value n or I? What did I use? Okay. Probability that g is n means you have n minus 1 tails followed by the first head. So you assume that the tosses are independent, so Q times Q times Q n minus 1, and finally you get your desired head P. So Q power n minus 1 times P for n equal to 1, 2, 3 and so on. Okay. Now what I will do, I want to compute the expected value of this random variable. So what is the expected number of tosses you want to make in order to get the first head? And also the variance of this geometric distribution, this random variable, where g. Okay. So this is where I will use infinite series, but now with a catch. I will put the value q for x in the infinite series. And the moment I want to put some value for q, I need to ensure that the series converges for the value of q that I have put. Okay, so let us see that this is fine, and this is the reason I have this 0 less than q minus 1, 0 less than q less than 1. In particular, this q less than 1 is very, very important in this context. Okay. Anyway, so we have already seen these examples. Let us first compute the expectation. 1 over 1 minus x whole square is 1 plus 2x plus 3x square and so on. Okay. Now, I want to put x equal to q. Therefore, I need to look at the convergence issues. But in your algebra course, in class 12 or somewhere, or maybe even after that, you know that the series converges for any real or complex value of x such that the absolute value of x is less than 1. It does not converge for any x whose absolute value is equal to 1. But anyway, since I am talking about absolute value of x, which is implied that 0 greater than equal to this. Okay, 0 less than equal to this. Anyway. So now I make use of the fact that q is less than 1. Right. Therefore, I am allowed to put x equal to q in this infinite series. So put x equal to q, then what do I get? 1 over 1 minus q whole square, but 1 minus q is p, so this is 1 over p square equal to 1 plus 2q plus 3q square and so on. But then what is the expected value of g? Okay. What is expectation? If g assumes the value 1, the probability is p. If g assumes the value 2, the probability is qp. If g assumes the value 3, the probability is q square p. If g assumes the value 4, q cube p. And so on. In general, if g assumes the value n, the corresponding probability is this. Okay, so we simply take the weighted sum of the values that g can take, and the weights are the respective probabilities. P, qp, q square p, qqp and so on. So now if I take p common from all these terms, what remains is 1 plus 2q plus 3q square plus 4q cube, and in general n q power n minus 1. And this already we have shown to be equal to 1 over p square. So this is p times 1 over p square, that is 1 over p. Okay. So this is an example of an infinite power series where I put a value for x. The moment I do it or want to do it, I must take care of the convergence issues. In this setting, this is fine, absolutely no problem, and therefore we obtain the expectation of g as 1 over p. Okay. And then we will do the similar thing for variance. Okay. A very, very similar thing for variance. Variance has a formula. This expected value of g square, okay, minus expected value of g square, whole square, this, okay. Expected value of g we have already derived as 1 over p, or 1 over p square. Okay, 1 over p, I will square it later. Expected value of g is 1 over p, so it suffices that I can compute this expectation, okay. So, what will be this expectation? This is 1 square times the probability of 1, probability that g is 1, plus 2 square times probability of g equal to 2 and so on. So, it's a equated sum of 1 square, 2 square, 3 square, 4 square and so on, and the weights had the respective probabilities. Okay. So that's it. Now, we have seen that this function 1 plus x over 1 minus x whole cube generates this sequence 1 square, 2 square, 3 square, 4 square and so on. Okay. Now we are interested in this 1 square, 2 square, 3 square because this is g square. Okay. Again, this was obtained by differentiating 1 over 1 minus x whole square. And this is once again valid. I mean, this convergence holds whenever the absolute value of x is less than 1. X may be any real or complex variable. Okay, or a complex number. In our case, it is the complex, it is the real number q. And under the assumption that q is less than 1, I can put q here. So 1 plus q, 1 minus q whole cube. This will give 1 square plus 2 square q, 3 square q square and so on. Okay. So, since this series converges for absolute value of x less than 1, there is no harm in putting x equal to q, and this gives me 1 square plus 2 square q plus 3 square q square and so on. This is equal to 1 plus q over 1 minus q whole cube, but 1 minus q is p, so this is 1 plus q over pq. So now let us look at this quantity, expected value of g square. So this is nothing but 1 square multiplied by the probability that g is equal to 1, 2 square multiplied by the probability that g is 2, 3 square multiplied by the probability that g is 3, and in general n square multiplied by the probability that g is equal to n. Again, if I take p common, I will have this sum. So this is p times this quantity 1 plus q over p cube. So this simplifies to 1 plus p over p square. So 1p cancels with this p. Finally, I use this expected value of g square, which is this, minus expected value of g square, which is 1 over p whole square. So, we get variance of g, 1 plus q over p square minus 1 over p whole square. So, this is 1 over p square. So, this cancels with this. What remains is q over p square. Okay. So, to sum up, infinite series, power series, can be used to solve a variety of counting problems and also are useful in the context of probability distributions. So I want to stop at this point in this lecture. I will continue with further applications of generating functions in the next two lectures. Okay, so bye.